Hello everybody, welcome to another episode of Astute Law Listen Up Podcasts. And today I've got the pleasure of having Neveen Galal of Amnesty Solicitors. She is an immigration lawyer specialist. How are you, Neveen?
I'm very well, thank you, Tosh. I'm absolutely delighted to be joined with you today.
So I wanted to bring you on board. You know what, we've got Brexit going on around the corner. A lot of my clients are asking about these sorts of questions. And I know one of the things you're gonna talk about today are the three key things employers need to do, or the steps they need to take in the wake of Brexit, which is only around the corner, right? Merry Christmas.
Yes. So
before we get into that, Naveen, tell us a little bit about yourself and, you know, how you help companies. Sure. So they can understand why is it anybody listening to this should be listening to you about this topic.
Sure. So I'm an immigration solicitor and I've been specialising in UK inbound immigration for 17 years. So I focus predominantly on regularising those who wish to reside and work in the UK. Prior to Brexit, it was predominantly personal immigration, but now in the wake of Brexit, there's a huge demand for corporate immigration and business immigration advice and services.
Right, right.
So that's my background. Yeah.
So what is it that...
So there's a few things...
Sorry, a little crossover there.
Sorry. Yeah, so no, I was just going to say there are a few things that I've identified that businesses really ought to be looking at, which is going to be the topic of the day.
So let's dive in, right? So it's around the corner. When is Brexit going to kick in? And what is it that employers should be doing now in terms of getting ready for it, and why?
Right, so first things first is free movement is coming. It is going to end on the 31st of December, so businesses need to be in play, ready to start the new year, 1st of January, fully immigration compliant. And yeah, things that I've identified that needs to be addressed are the right to work checks. So all employers, they need to do that, regardless of every aspect of employment. Whoever they employ, they have to carry out right to work checks. And I know that lots of people do not do that.
What is that very quickly, Naveen? What are the right to work checks?
The right to work check is essentially a delegated function that the UK government have imposed on employers to ensure that no business in the UK is employing anyone without the right to work.
Yep.
And that's normally evidenced by producing a EU passport, British passport, birth certificate. So it was never really a big deal up until now we are departing and going it alone, so to speak, as the UK is heading from the 1st of January.
Okay.
So at the moment, the UK government has given individuals from Europe the opportunity to document their right to reside and work under the EU settlement scheme. So that's one of the key points that employers really need to be doing. If they haven't already started now, they need to. And I would suggest take a holistic approach of all of your employees on your database, regardless of the size of your firm, identify whether or not they are from Europe or the UK, and have evidence on their personnel file to show that you've carried out the right to work checks.
So get the paperwork right, or you're going to get caught out.
Yeah, and I'll talk about the consequences. I'm not doing that shortly.
Yeah.
So employers really need to be looking at their workforce and identifying those who need to apply under the EU settlement scheme. Although free movement ends on the 31st of December 2020, and the rules come in on the 1st of January, there is a transitional period until the 30th of June 2021. If there's anyone who works for your business that hasn't applied under the EU settlement scheme by that date, that's it. They lose their right to work in the UK. It's all about documentation. And we know what happened with Windrush when people did not document their right to be here. It's no longer acceptable to just say, I'm from the EU, I can work for your company. The onus is on the employer to document that. And it's not difficult.
Doesn't everybody know that?
But it will save you.
I'm sorry, there's a slight delay, I think.
Surprisingly not.
Does everybody know that?
No, and that's what's surprising. And I'll give an example. I had one employer who came to me. He was just on the cusp of retiring when he got lifted with a massive civil penalty of £20,000 on the eve of his retirement, because he trusted his employee that he had the right to work here. And I'll tell you, he had an employee who'd worked for him for a number of years. I think it was over excess of 10 years. So there was no reason. It was almost like a friendship. And so he thought, he would never do me wrong. And it wasn't the employee that intentionally did him wrong. The employee had instructed a bit of a dodgy immigration advisor. He told him, we've renewed your application. You're just part of the backlog. You're part of the backlog. And what happened was, his application had never been submitted, but the employee didn't know. And so occasionally the employer would ask, what's going on with your immigration application? And the employer would say, oh, it's fine. I called my solicitor up and he's told me that I'm just still on the waiting list. Yeah.
Obviously, ignorance of the law is not a defence. I presume that solicitor was negligent.
Yes. But then where does that help the employer?
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, the employer got the civil penalty, and the civil penalty for unlawfully employing someone in the UK is £20,000 per employee.
Per employee.
Yeah. And it's documented right to work. It's not about saying, I know this person for X amount of years, they've worked with me for many years, or I can tell that they're from the UK, or I can tell that they're from Europe. It's about documenting it. And there's various ways of doing that.
Understood. So number one is get your checks in place, get the paperwork right so that you can be able to stand up. There's no point talking about it. You've got to have those checks in place. Those are checks that should effectively be done by somebody qualified like yourself, so that there's just no messing about. You've actually ticked everything off that checklist, if such a list exists.
Yes. If you've got a HR department, you might want to think about delegating those functions to your HR manager. If you're a slightly small entity, then you can do it yourself. However way you do it, even if you use a very small piece of software like Outlook, have a robust system in place so that deadlines aren't missed. Someone's visa is due for renewal. You need to be having that key date in your diary 1 month before renewal, and then a flag up reminder for its decision.
Makes sense. Of course it makes
sense. It does make sense. And it saves you the sleepless nights as an employer thinking immigration could come knocking on the door.
Yeah, 20 grand a pop.
Yes.
What's the second step?
Second step is identifying whether or not your business needs a sponsorship license. So this wasn't ever... So I'll tell you what that is. The sponsorship license is effectively a government approval for a company to employ skilled workers from outside of the UK.
Okay.
And again, it wasn't really a necessary thing for companies, because recruitment was never that difficult. We had free movement of European nationals into the UK who contributed vastly to our labour market. So there was never really that much of a need for companies to look globally. But now we're becoming a global partner with regards to other countries and the foreign migration of the global workforce. Now companies need to think about getting it if they need it, because it will apply to EU nationals.
Makes sense, of course, because now we've got a situation where the rules have changed, so you need to get a sponsorship license sorted out. So that will probably apply to quite a
license.
Few people, won't it? If you've been employing from abroad.
It will, but that's a lot more convoluted than, say, just recruiting people from the EU under the EU settlement scheme. Sponsorship license comes with a whole host of employer duties, and effectively you will have someone in your business who takes on the role of a pseudo immigration officer who monitors attendance, punctuality, visa renewals, visa expiries. And again, it goes back to my point about an employer having to have those robust checks and balances in place.
Got it. Got it. Mm. So check your paperwork, get your house in order. If you need a sponsorship license because you are employing people from abroad already, you better get those things in place. And you need to get all of those things in place by the 31st of December.
Well, I'd say start from now. Start the sponsorship license application now. If you're thinking about it, you're already late.
Because is there a time lag? Is there, Naveen, like a 6-week?
Well, there is, because it's about business continuity and avoiding any disruption. If you have a key employee that you need, you've got to factor in the costs involved for applying for the sponsorship license and the time frame. It used to be anything between 6 to 12 weeks, but now we're off the back of a pandemic. There's huge backlogs and delays already at the Home Office. Added to that is the number of companies now applying for it in that panic because of Brexit. So if you're already thinking about applying, you're too late. You need to start now. So my message that it is today, get your sponsorship license now.
Got it.
Don't wait.
And whenever this podcast is going out, today's the 17th of November, so get busy.
Get busy.
And what's the third step, Naveen? What's the third
step? And the third step, and I say this to all of my corporate clients, is it doesn't just end with the immigration compliance. You want to make sure that your policies, your procedures, your processes, your documentation are legally valid from an employment law perspective. You'll be surprised at the number of companies that come to me and say, I've got my contract of employment sorted, and I'll ask them where from, and they will say, Google or some other platform.
Yeah, off the shelf.
And that just is that, yeah, exactly. And that's just dangerous. There's no point protecting yourself from a civil penalty fine under immigration acts to then end up with potential discrimination or other employment related issues, because the contracts of employment do not support the employer in the eventuality that you have an employee who cannot document their right to be here, and then you need to protect yourself as a business owner by removing them from employment. I'm not an employment specialist, so I can't really go into too much details about
anyone
that.
Anyone you can recommend?
I always advise...
Is it
well, I've heard Tosh is very good.
And it doesn't have to be, just decide, it's not cost prohibitive. It can be quite straightforward. No. You just want to know what it is you need to do and protect your business interests. That's a very easy conversation. That's
exactly
with anybody, and you know, Naveen and I have known each other for years. So certainly that guy can help with that side of things. So that's the third thing, right? So it's, again, it comes back to your paperwork.
That's the third thing. Yes, it's all about documenting your processes, identifying your workforce. But please bear in mind, in case employers are listening to this and thinking that they're going to go on a massive sweeping spree and demand their staff to produce, the right to work checks do not change for European employees until the 1st of January. So you can't compel them to produce proof that they've applied under the European settlement scheme. You must from the 1st of January, however. But then it goes back to your right to work checks. And again, if you're ever in doubt, there's lots of information on the Gov website for employers. There's a sponsorship and employer helpline at the Home Office, and they can address any simple questions, or you can feel free to reach out to anyone at Amnesty Solicitors. We'll always be happy
absolutely
to help.
I would say that don't become a lawyer yourself if you're watching this. Make it easy to speak to an expert. You know, I say this in every single podcast, people will be sick of hearing it now, which is that, look, with all the experts that we have on our podcast, I'm not sitting in some ivory tower. You can call them up and they'll pick up the phone, and they are all genuinely people that I know who are experts in their field, genuinely nice, clever, intelligent and helpful. So, and Naveen's obviously one of those people. So I went that way, this way. She's definitely one of those people. So, look, what happens with these podcasts, Naveen, and it's the first one you've done with us, in fact, first of many, hopefully.
It's the first one I've ever had in my life.
Your contact details will go out with this podcast as well. So don't wait, just pick up the phone and speak to her to figure out how she can help. Naveen Galal of Amnesty Solicitors, thank you very much for participating in this. I'm really grateful to you.
Thank you for having me.
Please get on the phone now. Get the help if you need it, or get the information if you need it by reaching out to her. Or if you're feeling shy, you can do it through me. I'll put you in touch with her directly. Thank you again.
Thank you, Tosh. Thank you, everybody. An honour. Thanks.
Okay, everybody. Bye.